How's it going, everyone? And welcome to another Flesh and Blood video. My name is Kel, also known as Red Zone Rogue. And today we're going to talk about pitch. How much pitch should you include in your deck? I think this video is going to be pretty quick, but I think it's going to be very useful for a lot of new players or people who aren't used to brewing your own decks. And so what we're going to do here is I'm going to go over the latest deck that I have brewed. It is this Arachne Assassin Blitz deck, and talk about why I included certain pitch values in the deck, and maybe it will give you a better idea of what you should think about when you're brewing your own decks and how much pitch you should include. It's simple, but not, basically. So let's just start talking about it. Here we have the Mask of Perdition on here, just because I really love this card. It's one of my favorite cards. This one is not very relevant to the topic, but stuff like the Ornate Tezzan and the Spider's Bite are very, very important to the discussion today. And it all centers around how much pitch do you think you will need on an average turn? Not on an optimal turn, but the average turn, right? And, you know, it depends on your strategy. If you're gonna block, if you're not gonna block, you should probably block, or how much you plan to leverage your equipment like Mask of Perdition and Black Tech Whisperers here. In lieu of, you know, using cards to block, saving those cards for resources, or if you're running something like the Spring Tunic, so you can kind of depend on that resource once every three turns. Now, the big thing for me with this deck is Spider's Bite. Spider's Bite is a card that I want to attack with on average every turn or so. Not exactly every turn, depending on the hand, but a great turn for me would be attacking with Spider's Bite and then playing any other attack, hopefully two attacks, but I'm fine with just any other attack. And that for me requires three resources at most, two resources at minimum. So what that tells me is that I actually want a lot of yellow and blue cards in my deck so I could actually have these turns that I want to do, right? So I want to be able to attack with the Spider's Bite and then play any other attack in our deck. And because of the way we've built the deck, every other attack in the deck either costs one or zero, with one exception, which is the Surgical Extraction. But this is an outlier here. This is not our average turn. Our average turn will be Spider's Bite, pitching a blue card, hopefully, and then attacking with something like Annihilate the Armed or Eradicate, or even a zero drop like Leave No Witnesses. Bigger turns are obviously, you know, going to be bigger turns, like something with Art of War, but something like Art of War also really cares about having higher pitch. So when you play your Art of War, pitching a blue, you'll at least have two floating to be able to, you know, follow up with the shenanigans that Art of War enables you, right? Art of War can draw you two cards, so having those extra two resources at the ready to play the cards that you draw is very important. And so for me, when I'm thinking about this deck, I'm like, okay, I generally want three pitch, at least a blue in my hand, right? So how many blues do I need to put in my deck to have at least a blue almost every single turn? And for me, I'm running a little bit less than I should, I'll be completely honest. I'm only running nine blues. I am leveraging my tunic here a bit. But with even with nine blues in the deck, I do see them fairly often, right? So here is a simulation here. We can draw some cards. This is a hand where we have a blue. Here's a hand where we don't have a blue. In fact, this is a pretty awful hand. This is a hand we're going to probably be defending a lot, arsenaling our cash in, and then using these to defend here. There are also other considerations here, and that is our equipment and, you know, how we want to leverage resources when we're blocking, too. So let's go back to our main list here. Two important things for me for this deck are the Ornate Tezzan and the Ironhide Gauntlets. So even though the Ironhide Gauntlet is down here on the sideboard, I actually tend to run it a lot more than the Cracker Jacks. And what makes it useful is the Ornate Tezzan. Well, it makes it more efficient, I should say. So the Ironhide Gauntlet will block for two, but only if we pay one resource. And so that leaves us with, you know, potentially extra resources floating. You probably want some ways to actually use those extra resources. So blocking with an Ironhide pitching a yellow card, floating one resource, enables you to do something like activate Ornate Tezzan, which also costs a resource, to then use its effect of putting another card from your hand on the bottom of your deck and then drawing a card. And I really love, you know, play patterns like this, where you can get value out of a single card, you know, being able to block with your Ironhide, and then also get value out of your Ornate Tezzan. The reason we have the Ironhide here is because it's probably one of the better defensive options for the deck, depending on what we're playing against. And, you know, two block is not nothing. Also, I'd like to mention leveraging our equipment here. So the Mask of Perdition blocks for one, but it can come back over and over again as long as we can keep generating silver. Same with the Black Tech Whispers. And why this is important is because when you are thinking about a turn in Flesh and Blood, you're thinking about, okay, what do I need to be able to keep in my hand to still have a turn that is impactful after my opponent is done with their turn, right? And so you need to think about, like, okay, well, I can maybe leverage my Mask of Perdition and my Black Tech Whisperers as block, and then keep a two-card hand, keep a blue card, and then, let's say, you know, a one for five, like Rob the Rich, a one drop for five. And that's a two-card hand where you can still attack with a Spider's Bite, right, pitching a blue card, and then come in with the Rob the Rich. So that's still blocking, you know, with two cards, and then still coming in with two cards, which is fairly efficient here. And that's kind of one of the lower rate turns. You can have bigger, you know, higher rate turns too, if we generate a lot of silver, being able to play cash in, drawing two cards, and then going further beyond. So these are all things that you really should think about when you're constructing your deck. The thing, the most important thing that you should say to yourself is, how much pitch do I need to have a good average turn? Like I said, not the best turn, just a good average turn. And like I said, for this deck in particular, I found three to be a really, really nice sweet spot where you can Spider's Bite plus, you know, any one of your attacks down here. You can also do more, right? Obviously, you can do multiple attacks. You know, you can maybe annihilate the armed and then use Black Tech to give it go again, and then play a Rob the Rich or an E-Strike or something like that. There's a lot of different play patterns here. But the most important one is just thinking about what you need on an average turn. And then after that, you're like, okay, then what cards do I want to include as the blue cards or as the yellow cards? Now, sometimes you don't have options, right? Art of Wars only comes in yellow, so it's a yellow. Cash-In only comes in yellow, so it's a yellow. Eradicate, same thing. Surgical Extraction, same thing, right? So when you have options, what I like to do is to choose blue cards that still have an impact if I have to play them. And what do I mean by that? I think Shred is the perfect example, because I think blue Shred is so good. So it's a blue card, right? And it just says target defending, or target card defending an assassin attack gets minus two this turn. This minus two is still very, very impactful, because minus two is basically you know, a big equipment block. A lot of equipment will block for two. I don't actually have any in this deck. Well, we do, we have Ironhide. So say they also have an Ironhide, right, and they're blocking for two. Well, we can just use our blue Shred to basically counteract that, which is very strong. So this card, I'm very happy to play, and also very, very happy to use it as pitch. The same is true for something like, I think here are two options, well, actually a couple options here. So Annihilate the Armed, Rob the Rich, not this one, Plunder the Poor, and Slay the Scholars. Now, we have Annihilate the Armed and Rob the Rich. Now, these are both one for threes, but what I really like about them with our particular deck is we have the Cracker Jacks as a potential option. And so cracking the Cracker Jacks gives our next attack action card plus one, combined with one of these blue cards, actually makes this into a four, which is a really, really good break point. So on certain turns, if we have to play this Rob the Rich, we could leverage one of our equipment, Cracker Jacks, to still make it a difficult block for our opponent. Similarly is true for Plunder the Poor and Annihilate the Armed, where these only come in for two, but with some of our attack reactions like Shred, giving a card a minus two still gives us that four break point, because Plunder is only coming in for two. So once again, you need to think about this kind of stuff when you're building your decks. I like to think about like these break points, and for this one in particular, We are using a lot of reactions. All of our reactions, by the way, are +3 here or +2. None of them are lower than +2. So we know that when we're attacking with a Plunder the Poor or a, where's the other one? Plunder the Poor or a Slay the Scholars, if we have any attack reaction in our hand at all, we can hit that 4 breakpoint, which is really, really good. Which means that our opponent has to commit at least 2 cards to block to actually block it all out. So, yeah, that's basically what we're going to be talking about today. Please let me know if you have any questions down below. It's a skill that, you know, you'll get better at the more you build Flesh and Blood decks. I love building Flesh and Blood decks. I love brewing new decks and new heroes and new classes like Arachne and the Assassin class. Just makes it that much more exciting. And once again, I'll reiterate this. Just thinking about how much average pitch you need on a turn helps so much. So we have Arachne here, but you know there are also other decks too. Here, let me go go to my decks section, and let's just pull up what's a good example? Let's pull up this Valda deck. This is a little more complicated, but this deck runs a lot of blues. Here you can see up here that we have 20 blues, and that's because a lot of our attacks cost a lot to play. Like Mangle costs 4 here. We have Debilitate costing 4, Disable costing 5. So on average, we want to have more than 4 pitch in our hand. So we're running a lot of blues. Now this deck's a little bit trickier because Valda's going to be generating Seismic Surges to reduce the cost of the cards. And we do keep that into account when making this deck, but we still need a lot of blues. And so having 20 blues, half of the deck, is very important. Keep in mind also, this is a Ultimate Pit Fight deck, so this is made for multiplayer. But still, that's something that I keep in mind, right? I want to only include the most impactful red cards, like Spinal Crush or Pulverize, and then just use a lot of other blue cards that, you know, like I said, still have good impact, like Buckle, which is a fantastic example of a blue card that's still super good, or the one that looks like a metal album cover, Tear Asunder. Yeah, like this one, great blue, or even this round's on me. Thunderquake's a blue that attacks for 8. Yeah, these are all things that you should think about when you are building your deck and, you know, trying to determine what amount of blue. For yellows, honestly, yellows are a little bit trickier. A lot of folks will run red for, you know, maximum impact and blue for resources. And then also, you know, the effects occasionally. Like I said, buckle effect is quite good. Yellows, when I'm building decks, honestly, the yellows usually come in because either I need them for critical density of their effect, or just because they happen to be yellow, right? So like Art of War, Cashin. I really like this yellow Captain's Call here because it cares about cards that cost 1 or less, which is almost the entire deck. So we can use the yellow instead of the red and still get almost maximum effect out of this card. So we run the yellow instead of the red because it, you know, just pitches better. Same with something like Cut to the Chase. It's a 0 for +2, and like I said, for this deck, that +2 is still a really, really good breakpoint for us. And then sometimes you don't include reds where you don't think their effect was that useful. Like Shred here, the red Shred is a 0 for a -4, which is good, but, you know, it's not something that we absolutely need and doesn't give us that much of a better breakpoint. It does in some attacks, right? So, like, any of the 3 drops, getting a +4 is a really, really good breakpoint because that gives you 7. And 7 is one of the best breakpoints in Flesh and Blood. There are the breakpoints that you want to think about are 4, 7, and then 10. It's usually about 4 and 7, though, because most cards will block for a maximum of 3 here, unless they're an attack reaction. And so 4 means that they have to block with a card plus another card. And similarly, 7 means they have to block with 2 cards to make equal 6. And then another card to get past that to block the full thing. So anyway, that's a little crash course on Flesh and Blood. Thank you for joining me today. Like I said, my name is Kel, also known as Red Zone Rogue. You can go find me over on youtube.com/redzonerogue. And we'll see you next time.